Amen? You're saved, you know Christ tonight? Are you sure about that? The last verse says, I'm very sure. I could sing that. Not because I think I'm better than you tonight if you're lost. It's because I put my faith and trust in the anchor of my soul, Jesus Christ. He died on the cross for the sins of the whole world. Amen. Praise God for that. And if you don't know for sure where you would spend eternity tonight, you can settle that matter in your heart by receiving Jesus Christ. Amen. Boy, I tell you, we live in some times tonight. The songwriter back in 1944 wrote that song. Come on. Amen. In times like these, you know, if you study history in the 40s during World War II, amen, from 1939 to 45, people would have said, oh, I think Jesus, even so, come Lord Jesus, amen, come Lord Jesus. 1950s, the Korean War, oh, even so, come Lord Jesus, amen. Number, you know, in the 60s, the Vietnam War, amen. In the 70s, in the, every era, every decade, Christian says, oh, I think he's coming back now. He's got to come back soon. He's got, and you know what? He is coming back, but he's not coming back when we think he's going to come back. We think, oh, he's got to come back right now. Why? Because you said so? No, it's on God's timetable, not mine. So we're here. So God's gotten something for you to do if you're saved tonight. Amen? If God was finished with you, you'd be in heaven right now. But you're alive. Amen. So since you're alive, you're here, God's got something for you to do. If you're here and you're alive, amen, then you need, and you're not saved, you need to get saved. Then you start the journey. Then you start the course. Then you start the race. Amen. That's how it all works. Amen. And it's not a race to the finish line. It's just a race to finish. Amen. It's not a matter about who's first. Amen. Anyway, let's get into the message tonight. I'm just going to read a couple of verses in Matthew 24. We're going to continue on. You say, didn't we cover all of verse 20? No, we didn't. This is pretty slow, Pastor. All right, why are you in a hurry tonight? Amen. God's got laws, and I can't, what's that fancy theological word? Exegete. Every little thing out of the Bible. Because I'm not God. Amen. This is limited to my understanding to teach you and to help you. Amen. So anyway, Matthew 24, I'll read just two verses here tonight. And then we'll get into the study tonight and try to help you. Amen. And just make sure, you know what? Make sure devices are turned down or muted or do not disturb or focus mode or all those crazy buttons that you can push to kind of get the machine or the devices to kind of like not interrupt us tonight. Amen. And so anyway, let's see here. I'll read the passage here. For then, verse 21, shall be great tribulation such as was not since the beginning of the world. To this time, no, nor ever shall be. And then I believe we'll get into some of verse 22, and I have a bunch of material on that one. Anyway, verse 20, and except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved, but for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. Let's pray. Father, again, bless your word. Bless our time together tonight as we look at your word. Give us understanding. Fill me and use me. And Lord God, again, touch the hearts and lives of those here in-house, present with us tonight, and those watching online. May you do a great work, Lord God, and only you can do that. So, Father, we look to you today. And Lord, as we prepare to finish this year off, Lord God, help us tonight to be in a right place with you, Lord. Just touch each and every heart and life, and we'll thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, so Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. And again, we've covered a bit on this verse 21, but we'll cover some more. And again, the Bible says here, verse 21, for then shall be great tribulation. Amen. great tribulation, not just a little, as you already know if you've been with us, and I don't have time to review every little thing, but if you've been with us, we covered verse 15. Verse 15 is the midpoint of the tribulation. This is a time where those who don't know Christ will be entering into Daniel's 70th week. This is not, you have no reservation for this time frame if you're saved tonight. We have been spared from the wrath to come if you're saved. Amen? Thank God for that. Praise God. Those who try to teach otherwise are teaching false doctrine. I didn't say they weren't saved. I just said they're teaching false doctrine, okay? Listen, the problem that we got today, it's what we're doing right now with YouTube, okay? What do you mean? You can go on YouTube and find anything that you want to watch and listen to. I'm not saying everything's bad out there. I'm not even saying we're the only ones preaching the truth. I just want you to know, you better be discerning what you watch and listen to. Amen? Be discerning. You say, Pastor, I wonder about this person or that or this group or, you know, whatever. Ask questions. Amen? I don't know it all. You may ask me a question. Oh, I'd never heard that one before, you know. But just be discerning. But there's a lot of confusion out there. And there's groups out there that will preach and teach that the church has got to go through half or three quarters of the tribulation that we've been discussing. All I say to you is this, you stick with the Bible and don't listen, rightly divide the scriptures, the Bible says. Isaiah says, line upon line, precept upon precept, okay? This book is fits together perfectly. There's no contradictions in it. And you got to rightly divide it. Otherwise, for instance, those three main distinctions. Amen? You got the Jew, Gentile, and the church. Okay? And if you don't maintain the distinction that those are three groups that are covered in the Bible. Okay? When you read a passage, who is he talking to? Is he talking to the Jews? Who are they? Descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Is he talking to, well, if they're not Jew... And by the way, just because if you're a Jew tonight, amen, and you haven't come to Christ, then you're still just a Jew. But if you get saved as a Jew, Jesus says, set aside that Jewish heritage for a minute, and now you're in Christ. You're part of the church, amen? And for a Gentile, meaning someone who's lost but is not a Jew, that means everybody else on planet Earth that's not saved, is called the Gentile in God's eyes. So he says, I got people in this world that are Jewish, have a physical heritage back to a guy named Abraham. And then we got people, everyone else that's not saved. And then those who are saved. If you're saved, you're the part of the church tonight. Amen? Church of God. That's 1 Corinthians 10:32. And we'll mention that again because some people just don't understand that principle in the Bible. Amen? So it's important to keep things straight. Our whole Daniel study for months, okay? We went through all of this. You know, you can watch the whole study online on YouTube, but if you want to focus just on one part, go to Daniel 9 in the study and watch that, read it, listen to it, read the Bible verse by verse, and I take you through, and I have so many YouTube videos, just why the church is not going through the tribulation. We will face tribulation. What's that? Trials in life. We all do. But you're not going to, we are not appointed to Daniel's 70th week. That was reserved for the nation of Israel. So if you get that straight, you already know right away that the elect is not the church in verse 22, which we'll get to. But that's where people put the church in the tribulation. They don't understand the usage of the word elect and election. And because of that, you get people saying, oh, there the church is in there. No, it's not. That's not the church. Amen? And we'll see if we get to that. We're going to look at how the word elect is used in the Bible, okay? We're going to go through that. And some of that, of course, is a crossover between those who may not ascribe to Calvinism, but yet would put the church in the tribulation by a misuse, misapplication of the elect that's mentioned in Matthew 24. Amen. And so there's a crossover in teaching, which I'll have to cover too, to help people understand about who are the elect. How does one become one of the elect? How about that? Amen. And how does that all work? And so we're going to try to get into all of that, okay? So, important stuff. Let's revert back to verse 21 about the great tribulation, amen? It's the great tribulation is the last 3.5 years, technically, okay? That's from verse 15 down. But the tribulation is the whole 7-year period, okay? And so anyway, the Bible says it mentions 1,260 days, which is the last half, 42 months, which is 3.5 years, okay, of the 7 divided by 2. It's simple math, amen? So anyway, when you look at the Bible, you'll read from Revelation 6. It's pretty much in chronological order, for the most part, Revelation, from chapter 6 to 19. The church is not even present. Revelation chapter 4, verse 1, the Bible even gives a picture of what would take place when the rapture happens, and he says, come up hither, a voice as of a trumpet. Okay? That's the trump of God. God calls his church up, we're out of here, right till chapter 19, and then we come back with Christ on horses. Amen? The battle of Armageddon. Anyway, we're absent. The church is absent. Praise God. Amen? And so you don't have to worry about that stuff. I'll tell you, the Great Tribulation, there's going to be hundreds of millions of people, I'm telling you, that will die. Hundreds and hundreds of millions of people that will die. After 21 judgments that fall upon this earth, boy, I'll tell you, the population will be severely reduced. I'm telling you, everything, like the Bible we just read. He says, it's not since the beginning of the world to this time, nor ever shall be. There will be no time that was ever worse than that time. How about that? Man, I'll tell you, I'm glad I'm saved tonight. I'm not going to be here. The Lord says he's going to call up his bride. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. He's going to take his bride away. Amen. Praise God. Amen. You're saved. You're called the bride of Christ. It's singular. How about that? Amen. When we get into Matthew 25 about the virgins, plural, there's a reason why the word virgins are used there. Amen. It's a different concept as opposed to the church with a bride, singular. We're one in Christ. Amen. We're many members, but one body. There's one head. Amen. It's just simple. 1 Corinthians 12, 1 Corinthians 14. So anyway, so you put all these scriptures together, and you know, this is what you have. There's other places. In two other places, the phrase great tribulation is used. Revelation chapter 2, verse 22. Look at Revelation chapter 7, verse 14. I want you to turn there for a minute. Revelation chapter 7, verse 14. Revelation chapter 7, verse 14. Look at verse 13. And one of the elders answered and said unto me, what are these which are arrayed in white robes? And whence came thee? And some people understand this. It will be tough to get saved in the tribulation. The Bible says in over in 2 Thessalonians that God will send a strong delusion. Say, why would God do that? Because the people that entered didn't want God to begin with. They rejected God. So he lets them have what they want. They don't want God. They don't get God. That's so terrible. They didn't want him. If they want him, get saved right now. Why are you waiting for? Come to Christ tonight. Amen. Tonight's the day, your time of salvation. So he says, so what are these people? Watch this, verse 14, I said unto them, sir, thou knowest. He said to me, these are they which came out of great tribulation, have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. That's, well, you know what it is? Some people will be getting saved in the tribulation. Bless God. But don't count on it. Well, I'll wait till the great tribulation to get saved. Really? Bible says there'll even be people that will want to repent and they won't. They can't. How about that? You say, well, this will be easy. No, it won't be. Get saved now. This is as easy as it gets. When I'm not preaching what you call, you know, easy, what they say, easy believes. I just believe that you got to receive Christ. End of story. Amen. And make sure that you understand sin, that your sin results in punishment, death, and in hell, and that Christ paid for your punishment on the cross, sins, your sins, the whole sins, all the sins. Amen. And all you got to do is put your faith and trust in what he did, because, listen, at the great white throne judgment, people, listen, there's, if you aren't saved and you want to go by your works, you're going to fail that test. That's why you need to turn to God and trust him by grace through faith. Amen. If you don't do that, you're lost. You'll lose out. Amen. I'll tell you. Anyway, so those are in the tribulation there. Amen. So you see the word phrase, great tribulation. Now watch this. Go to Mark 13. Mark 13, that's the other comparative passage to the Matthew 24. You might want to keep a marker in Matthew 24, just in case. If you know your Bible, you don't need to mark it. You know, you got it there. You keep your hand here and there. Amen. Mark chapter 13, and then look at verse 14, when you shall see the abomination of desolation spoken by Daniel the prophet. Matthew and Mark are pretty close to each other. Okay, you can kind of follow them together. So that's the midpoint of the 7 years, okay? The same thing what we saw in Matthew 24. And he says, watch this, and we'll skip down, let's see here. Verse 19, and in those days shall be affliction, such as was not from the beginning of the creation, which God created unto this time, neither shall be. How about that? Take all the disasters, take all the earthquakes, take all the pestilences, which qualifies COVID in that category, just in case you didn't know, and all the things that's ever happened in the history of mankind from the creation of the earth, and compress them into the tribulation. How about that? God says, nothing has ever been as bad as it will be on that 7-year period. Boy, thank God you're saved. If you're saved tonight, if you're not, like I said, you keep on asking. Yeah, I know, because it's important. You don't know the day or the hour, the times or the seasons. What are you waiting for? If you believe, receive. Amen. You got to receive tonight. So anyway, it's a time of trouble. The Bible says, keep your place in Matthew. Now we're going to go Old Testament. We're going to flip around. You'll say, wow, we're going here and we're going there, and You know what? That's where the Bible, you do study in the Bible and you read and you say, God, help me, and God, please show me from your word. Amen. You know what? Thank God for the truth. Thank God for the words that you have. You know what? I don't want you to turn around and look at me and say, hey, pastor, where you made a statement, but I want to know where in the Bible it says that. Amen. Well, I'm glad you asked, because that's where we need to go. It's the Bible's the standard. It's not me. And I do stand to be corrected. Amen. I'm not perfect. I'm serious. Some people say, well, pastor, what about? Yeah, you know what? Sorry, I forgot about that one. Amen. Anyway, so what does he say here? He says in Joel chapter 2, verse 2, what is it? A day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness as the morning spread upon the mountains, a great people and a strong. There hath not been ever the like. Did you get it? Never the like. What's going to take place in that time? Neither shall be any more after it. It's a reference to the future. It's prophetic. Amen. To the 7-year tribulation. How about that? And he says, even to the years of many generations. Wow. Amen. You know, the Bible doesn't contradict itself. Amen. It doesn't. Oh, I'm sorry. Joel 2:2. I'm sorry. Forgive me. I forgot to mention. Everybody, Joel 2:2. Okay. Amen. So anyway, that's that reference. Okay. And I think we referenced Daniel chapter 12, verse 1 before, but let's go over there. Amen. Here we go again. Daniel, Joel, here. Amen. It's Bible time. Bible time. Amen. We go by the Bible. Scripture with scripture. Verse by verse. Amen. That's what we need to do. Oh, I'm in Hosea. What am I doing here? I need to go Daniel. There we go. Daniel, then Hosea. Chapter 12. Amen. Wonderful chapter. I kind of reference a little bit to it. about they that be wise in verse 3. If you were here Sunday or you watched online there, Daniel chapter 12, verse 1, at the time shall Michael stand up, the great prince withstandeth for the children of thy people. Notice, who is thy people? In reference, in context, Daniel 12 is speaking of the nation of Israel. Those are the people that are being referenced. The Old Testament was written in Hebrew. What group of people has the language of Hebrew? It's God's chosen people, okay? The book was given to them. And you say, what about these Gentiles? Here and there we read about, whenever Gentiles interacted with God's chosen people, God records some events in the Bible. But if there's no interaction, he doesn't really record, you know, these other Gentile countries. That's what we found in the book of Daniel, all these things that were going on, amen? So look at this. So, and he says here, thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble. Jeremiah 30, verse 7 says, it's Jacob's trouble, not the church's trouble. Jacob's trouble, amen? It's a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation even to that same time. And at that time, thy people shall be delivered. There's going to be a deliverance to God's chosen people. It'll be a small percent. It will be a remnant of God's chosen people. Everyone that shall be found written in the book, they have to be saved. Amen? They have to be saved, just like you and I have to be saved. So what is God going to have to do during that tribulation? He's got to purge some things. He's got to purge some people. The Bible talks about that. Go over to Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter, let's see here, 20. I love that chapter. Ezekiel is just before Daniel there. Amen. You say, you refer to these chapters a lot because they're so powerful. They're powerful. Ezekiel 20, Ezekiel chapter 20 is a mini history of the nation of Israel. If you ever spent time reading this chapter here, okay, you read this chapter, you'll find when you start at verse 1, okay, when he gets down to verse 5, from 5 to 9, it rehearses what happened in Egypt. Verses 10 to 17 rehearses what happened between Egypt and Kadesh Barnea. And then when you get to verses 18 to 26, it's all about the 40 years wandering. It's just little mini summaries. And in verses 27 to 29, it's when they enter into Canaan. And then verses 30 to 32 is Ezekiel's own generation are being referenced here. And then verse 33 on is the future judgment of the nation of Israel, which is what I'm going to refer to here. Okay? So, I mean, you know, you say, wow. And you know what? I've mentioned this many times. It's full of idolatry, their history. And that's the transgression that Daniel 9 talks about, that he has to finish the transgression. For the church age saint, that's been done on the cross. But God's got some business to deal with his earthly physical people that hasn't been finished yet. Amen? Because they haven't received their Messiah. They haven't received Christ. You know, we need to pray for the Jews. Amen? They need the Lord. They need their eyes open to know that he's come. He's come. You don't want to meet him the next time. Amen. You want to meet him now on this side of the rapture. Amen. So what has he got to do? So the Bible says that he has to prepare her for this redemption. As I mentioned, Rita, go back a couple of messages on YouTube or whatever. I talked about Israel's wilderness experience. Amen. And what God's going to do. This is all part of that. So there has to be a purging. Watch this. In verse 33, as I live, saith the Lord God, surely with a mighty hand, with a stretched out arm, and with fury poured out, will I rule over you. And I will bring you out from the people, and will gather you out of the countries wherein you are scattered. This is going to happen right after the rapture. As soon as we're taken out, these people, all over, all the Jews, everywhere in the world. Now, there's different thoughts how this can happen, but some people, some Bible scholars and believers and teachers and preachers believe that probably some governments are going to force them out of these lands to go back, maybe, or they'll just have an affinity to go back to their land. But anyway, we know this, they all got to be back in their land. We know temple worship, the temple will be rebuilt. They'll resume their worship. They'll do all of that. And so anyway, he says, but I'm pulling you out. And then after they bring him in, then he says in verse 35, there's a big gap between 34 and 35 in time, and I will bring you into the wilderness of the people. And there will I plead with you face to face. You know, God's pleading with people tonight. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavily laid, and I'll give you rest. Amen. He says, come on, come to know me tonight. You know, amen. Come receive me as your Savior tonight. What are you waiting for? Amen. Boy, I tell you, the devil doesn't want any more people to get saved. And he surely wants to wreak havoc in Christians' lives. He wants Christians to get so sidetracked on everything else that we don't focus on Christ hardly at all in our lives. And we don't really are not used as God would have us to be used. See, these bodies are not our own. We're not our own. Paul wrote to the Corinthian believers, we've been bought with a price. All right, is this body that you have, you're using it for the Lord and the work of God? Amen. That's what God wants us to do. Amen. Use our bodies for Him. Amen. Serve Christ. Live for God. Amen. Love people. Get the gospel out. And he says, like I pleaded with your fathers in verse 36, in the wilderness, amen, of the land of Egypt, so will I. This is, you know, I circled all, will I and I will, God says, amen. Verse 37, I will cause you to pass under the rod, and I will bring you into the bond of the covenant. Watch this. And I will purge out from among you the rebels. God says, I'm going to, people who are rebelling against me, they'll be purged out. Amen. They won't make it. They won't make it. God's got to do that. God's got to do that. Amen. You say, that's so terrible. They don't want God. They're rebelling. Amen. People say, well, that's a terrible God you believe in. If you don't want God, you say, well, I don't believe the Bible. I'll tell you this, when it comes down to it, especially at the end of the tribulation, everybody believes. They all believe. They all believe. I didn't say they all get saved. I mean, they all believe that this book was true. They realize, they find out that what we said to them from the Word of God was true. Amen. I'm telling you, it's going to be tough. It's going to be tough for some people. You know, we believe the truth. Believe the truth. Amen. This is the truth. Not me. The Bible's the truth. Amen. And then he says, I'll purge you. And then them that transgress against me, I will bring forth out of the country where they sojourn. They shall not enter the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. He is the Lord. Amen. Praise God. You know, you go to Zechariah 13. Let's go over there. Keep your place in Matthew 24. Haven't forgotten. Amen. Amen. Okay. Zechariah. Boy, I love this book too. They're all good books. Amen. Every book's a good book in here. Amen. Spend more time in the book. Amen. Spend more time in the book. Well, I tell you, I love chapter 12, verse 10, and I will pour up upon the house of David, upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the spirit of grace and of supplications, and they shall look upon me whom they have pierced. Amen. The Jews will see the one they pierced. You know what? They shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn. You know what the Bible says? Oh, I tell you, he's got wounds in his hands. He's got a wound in his side. Amen. Again, I don't mean to be critical of the songwriters. It's nailed, scarred hands. No, they're not scarred. They're as fresh. You know that resurrected Savior for 40 days before he ascended up? It wasn't scars. There were wounds. It was a body of flesh and bone. Amen. And I'm telling you, they're going to see him. They're going to see him. But look at chapter 13. Look at chapter 13 and look at verse 8, okay? And again, this is all future. And I mentioned this in a few messages ago. And it shall come to pass in all the land, say the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die, and a third shall be left. So two-thirds will be wiped out of God's people, God's earthly people. The Jews, they'll die in that tribulation. Amen. And I will bring the third part through the fire and will refine them as silver is refined and try them as gold is tried. They shall call on my name and I will hear them and I will say, it is my people. And they shall say, the Lord is my God. Praise God. They'll come as one man, the Bible says. They'll receive the Messiah finally. Amen. Wow. Praise the Lord. What a blessing. Amen. I'll tell you what, you know what? I don't know about you, but that excites me. That really excites me. That touches my heart. Amen. Anyway, let's finish up here. So the Bible says, go back to Matthew 24. So again, this is a future time. This is future. Preterism, historicism, what it is. What is that? It's past. They say it's all past tense. It's all happened. Really? It hasn't happened. So what do? They spiritualize all the stuff I just told you. They spiritual all of Revelation. Oh, that's just spiritual. It's metaphors, symbolism. That's what they say. No, it's yet to come. Amen. Futurist. If someone's put a label on you and I, we believe in the future. We believe that's future tense. It's not right now. Praise God. Amen. Thank the Lord for, praise God. Amen. So it's future. It's the worst time in the history of the world. For everybody in the world, but especially the Jewish people. But he will deliver those who come to faith in Christ as they see him. Amen. That, you know, he's going to plead with them. The Bible says, please, come on. Amen. Oh, I'll tell you. He says, they'll come to him in faith. Amen. In this time. And anyway, all of these have to come to pass because God said it. Amen. Everything God says comes to pass. You can trust God. Study history. There's things written many years in advance. I mean, we just celebrated Christmas about the birth of Christ. Amen. You know, we can argue. People out there will say, well, I don't know if I believe he's God, but they can't deny there was a man named Jesus Christ. They cannot. It's impossible. You have to deny history. Well, we go a step further. History does attest to a man named Jesus, but he's more than a man. He's the God-man. He's the God-man. Amen? Praise the Lord for that. And anyway, so again, so as we go through this thing here, God's purpose for the tribulation, the main focus is dealing with his earthly physical people and all the other people are surrounding that. Amen? And of course he wants people to come to know him. But it'll be a tough time, amen? It's to bring to faith the elect Jewish remnant, okay? And we're going to get to that shortly. We'll try to cover at least the definitions of that, amen? And so there'll be a national conversion that will be taking place someday. You won't be here if you're saved. You'll be up there, amen? Praise the Lord. And so let's move on here. Verse 22, Matthew 24. And except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved, but for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. Okay? So here's what we need to do. We need to, again, make sure that we understand, first of all, the first part of this verse. It says about those days should be shortened. Well, we know this. It's a set time. And there's a bit of mystery of that statement. Some people say, well, see, it's got to be short. So therefore, that's why the pre-wrath position fits in, because it's not the whole 7 years. And he's come, you know, the church only goes through part of that and all this other mumbo jumbo or whatever. But anyway, that's what they say. They have all their different things here. But I know this. You know what? Didn't God create time? He created time, okay? Can God speed up time? If he wants to, you might not even know it. You know what? The Bible tells us in Daniel again, I won't turn there again, about knowledge would increase. I mean, you got to think about, we got all this technology and these devices. People got access not only to all the garbage of the world, but they got access to the truth of Christ and the Bible. And it turns out, what do they desire? They want the garbage? They're going to eat from the garbage dump, so to speak, or are they going to turn to Christ? Amen? And listen, I'm telling you, tonight, it's accessible. And we got all this knowledge, but are people... You know, I don't know where everybody's getting saved on planet Earth right now. I believe people are getting saved. To what degree? I don't know. I just know this. One of the things I have seen, and I'll attest to this, there are believers who are fallen in sin and are becoming rendered useless at the time because they don't repent, they don't deal with it, their sin, and they're not as useful for the cause of Christ as they should be. And because of that, we're not the salt and light that we should be. Amen? And if we're not the salt and light, we don't have that effect that salt and light has an effect on a world of darkness and a world that needs some savor. We're supposed to be that. So I know this, one of the things that really has affected the movement of the gospel is Christians not being engaged in the gospel. We're more engaged in all kinds of other stuff, maybe not even wicked bad things. Sometimes, yes, it leads to, there are some things that people end up in sin. Amen? So we need to make sure we stay focused. We need to give God, listen, all of my life, my time, my energy, everything I have is His. It's not mine. I don't own anything. In God's eyes, as a believer, you're saved. You don't own anything. You're just a steward of everything. That's all you and I are. Just like Joseph in the Bible. He was a steward. He didn't own anything. Amen? And because of his faithfulness, God moved him up. And by the way, we will resume the Genesis study, amen? And that will be not this Sunday, but the following Sunday. We'll resume all services, okay? So anyway, what am I telling you? If the Bible says 1,260 days, it still has to be 1,260 days. Otherwise, God's a liar. Amen. 42 months, the last time, that has to be exactly those times. So we can't shorten that up. So what is it? I'm not 100% sure, but possibly maybe God's going to speed the clock up. Amen. But I know this, when 21 judgments on the earth, there's going to be a depletion of the population of the earth. It will be drastic. You know, people watch these, apocalyptic movies, you know, and we think, well, you know, we just kind of look back and say, wow, that would be terrible. I really believe some of those are a little more truer to fact than fiction. What do you mean? You know, I've seen some of them. Take away all the guns and all the helicopters and tanks and everything. I mean, the Bible says when the armies cross, they have to cross over the Euphrates, but it's got to be dried up for them to cross. You don't need all that if you got all the gear that we got tonight in the military forces around the world. So something has to happen. It talks about bows and arrows. I believe technology is going to crash someday. It may crash before Jesus comes back. I don't know. I'm not prophesying anything. Because everybody's so connected. They're connected to everything else but God. Really, when you get down to it. Isn't that right? And again, I got the tools. I use it. I don't let it control me. I control it. If it controls you, put it down. Put it down. Amen. So anyway, so there's more to be said about that. And no flesh should be saved, okay? You know what? The goal of the Antichrist and of Satan is to destroy his earthly physical people in that time of tribulation. You know what? From the time that the Jews, God chose a man. God chose the nation of, he chose it through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. From that point forth, I'm telling you, they have been through a lot. And yes, a lot of it, God said, if you don't obey me, I'm going to let these nations around you kind of be like scourges in your sides and afflict you. You know, God kept his word. God kept his word, amen? But God also said in Genesis 12, he gave like an unconditional promise. Them that bless them, he'll bless them. And them that curse them, he'll curse them. And you study history. You study history for the last few thousand years, and you find out what nations, how they dealt with the God's earthly physical people, and you'll find out they're not ever what they used to be. Man, I'll tell you, again, you know what? I pray for those people. I pray for them, and I pray and hope they open their eyes for the gospel. Amen? That's what. So, here comes the question here. So, when you get down to the other part of the verse 22, he says, but for the elect's sake, those days should be shortened. So, the short answer right away, based upon all the teaching, all the preaching, verse with verse, you know, line upon line, precept upon precept, okay? We know this, it can't be the church. You know what? YouTube. Praise the Lord, whatever, it's a medium that we're using. But it doesn't matter how many people have subscribed or not to me. As long as they're blessed and people get saved, that's fine. But if the numbers go up and down, and I believe maybe we'll have some numbers drop after this message and next week's message. I guarantee you. I'm going to guarantee you that. I'm not trying to drive people away from the channel. I'm just trying to get the truth out. But I know I'll get some comments on there. And I have any inappropriate comments, I have them for, I have to moderate those. And some of them they don't. I know Scott got one last on Sunday. We don't even know what it was about, but people try to spam the channel, okay? Anyway, people do that. They think, oh, that's great, you know, wonderful, but you got to watch some other inappropriate comments. And I have a filter on there from YouTube for that. But anyway, so we know this, it's not the church. So let's start, and we'll see what we can cover in this portion, and we'll have to continue on next week. It'll get pretty hot next week. I'm serious. Because I'll say it right up front, I don't ascribe to Calvin's Institutes. I don't. Someone say, are you a one-pointer, two-pointer, three-pointer, four-pointer, five-pointer? I'm a zero-pointer, as Calvin taught. I have yet to meet a true five-point Calvinist that agreed and believed everything that John Calvin taught. Because you study history, whoa. It was a state religion in Geneva, and he tortured people, and he put people to death. You study your history. I don't know about that, John Calvin. Yeah. That's the John Calvin I'm talking about. You say, how could he? I've read some of his institutes. Boy, they're wonderful. That's what he did. The reason why people are ignorant and we're losing our history tonight is because people are trying to erase history. We need to learn from the past. We don't need to repeat it. So if you erase it and you hide the bad parts or the parts that you don't want people to know about, then they won't learn from it. That's where we're at in 2021. Heading into 2022. We're trying to hide. Listen, I'm not endorsing everything that's happened in Canada and the U.S. in the last 100, 200 years, or 300 or 400 years. I'm not. But the reality is, we need to learn from that. What a famous saying, it's been said many different ways. One way is this: what men learn from history is that they don't learn from history. And that's the problem we face tonight. Young people tonight need to know their history. They need to know that. And if you don't know that, you're doomed to repeat it. The Bible's full of history. You want to know what not to do or what to do? Study the history books in the Bible. God gave them to us. He says they're written for our admonition. Paul wrote in the Corinthian believers. They're in samples. You've got to spend time. The reason why we repeat things and we head down the same paths and roads that are not right, not good, is because we have not studied and read the Bible. So we end up messing up again. Amen. You got to learn from your past, okay? You made some bad choices, some bad decisions. Have you made some changes? If you don't, you're going to go down. You know, it's like repeatability in chemistry. I love chemistry class. Back there in 1973. I remember some stuff, not everything. But 1973, when I took chemistry. Well, let me tell you something. There's repeatability in experimentation. After a while, if you don't change any parameters, you get the same results. Amen? Certain experiments. Well, it's the same with life. You don't change any parameters, you're going to end up in the same mess in the same place. You got to change something. Amen. Someone said the definition of insanity is doing the same thing and expecting a different result. And that's about the size of it. If you don't change anything, you're going to end up in the same mess, same problem, same everything again and again and again. You got to change something. Anyway, that's not in the notes, but it was in the heart, okay? Anyway, so let's start with number one. He's the most important. You say, what is he? Who is he? I'll identify him for you in a minute. Isaiah chapter 42. So who is the elect? Who is? How is that word used in your Bible? You know, it's just a word study. I can come up with whatever I want. And by the way, can I just say this? And this is not a statement that anybody who doesn't use the King James Bible is bad and wicked and terrible. But listen, I have studied this for the last 47 years. There's 95% of the manuscripts attest to the veracity of the King James Bible. Why would I want to try any other one? You say, I like these versions. You want accuracy? Listen, every new Bible that comes out comes from the same families, the Alexandrian texts in Egypt. They all do. The other ones, the King James, all the texts come from Syria, the Syrian, the Antiochian text. You know what? Stick with this. I don't like the these and thous. I don't talk that. Neither do I. I don't talk these and thous, but they're more definitive. So I didn't know that. Well, I'll give you a handout if you want one. I'll show you these pronouns. Why did they use them? They're very precise. Amen. Anyways, it's not an issue. Listen, are you saying people can't get saved unless they read a King? No, of course not. But you want accuracy? But there's so many changes, thousands of changes in those new Bibles that detract. Can you find the virgin birth in the new Bibles? Yes, but it's been diminished. The blood atonement, the virgin birth, the Trinity. We go on and on. And it's just not one or two places. It's all over. So anyway, again, it just people don't know because they just trust the preacher that if you have a preacher here, you kind of put your trust in me. You should put your trust in God, number one, but maybe you need to study this issue. So Isaiah 42, so based upon the King James Bible, so if you're using another version, well, my Bible doesn't say that, and that's why I believe I don't agree with what you're saying, preacher. There's your first problem. So I got to give you a manuscript evidence course or class to help you learn why that translation was in error when it changed that word. Because there's a good reason why we have the words that we do in this Bible. Verse 1, behold, my servant, whom I uphold, mine elect, in whom my soul delighteth, I have put my spirit upon him. He shall bring forth for judgment to the Gentiles. He shall not cry, nor lift up, nor cause his voice to be heard in the street. A bruised reed shall he not break, and the smoking flax shall he not quench. He shall bring forth judgment into truth. He shall not fail nor be discouraged till he have set judgment in the earth, and the isle shall wait for his law. Now, this is not a trick question. Who do you think that is? Anybody? You can say it. They might not hear you over on the line. Okay, you say, I'm not too sure about that, Pastor. Luke chapter 4, how about that? You want to keep your place there? Wonder who that is. I wonder who that is. Who is that referring to? Mine elect, who's that? I'm glad you asked. Amen? You want to give me a question? I'll try to give you an answer. Verse 16. And he came to Nazareth. Who's he there? Who is it? Jesus. Amen? Where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day. By the way, it's good to have some customs. Well, I don't think we have to go to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. There's nowhere in the Bible that says you have to do that. But I have a verse that says, so much the more as you see the day approaching, we should have assemblies together. Not so much the less. All I've seen the last 30, 40 years amongst many churches is, well, they drop that service, they drop that service, they drop that service. And listen, I struggle with dropping a service. Just in case you thought, oh, I'm in thrilling and joy of dropping a service every now and again. No. But we're not, listen, we are resuming all our services as the Lord allows. Amen? And when the government said, you know, regular services, well, the average church in our town only had one service, maybe on a Sunday morning. Maybe they had to have multiple services, but it's Sunday morning. Many of them didn't have Sunday night services. Many of them didn't have midweek services. They got rid of those years ago. I've had this since I became pastor here, and my predecessor had services. I got saved in the church that had all these services. Nothing's changed in the 47 years I've been saved. You're saying you're not right with God? But how hungry are you? Are you hungering and thirsting after righteousness? So you'll stay home and you'll watch something on TV, watch a flick or a movie or something, when you could be under the preaching and teaching of God's word. What people need is more. Come on. Amen. So Jesus had a custom. That's good. You got a custom? No wrong to have customs. Paul even wrote to Timothy, says, now keep the traditions. They weren't traditions that contradicted the teachings of the Bible. They were just traditions. You might not have a Bible verse for it, but they're not wrong. You got traditions in your, we just did some Christmas celebrations. You got some, praise God. As long as they don't contradict the Bible, we're good, amen? So watch this. And verse 17, and there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah, and when he opened the book, he found the place where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of the sight to blind, to set at liberty to them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And he closed the book and he gave it to them, the minister, and sat down. The eyes of them that were on the synagogue were fastened on him. Listen, he said this, he began to say unto you, this day is the scripture fulfilled. Now listen, Christ is the one that is being spoken of in this passage. Let's see here, I have another passage here I'm missing here, and I'm trying to remember where it is. Let's see here, hang on here. I'll find it. Okay, Matthew 12. That's it. Go to Matthew 12. That wasn't really the exact passage. I don't know why I got that one down there. Hang in there. Amen. Here we are. I don't know why I put that one down, but that's a good passage. Verse 17. And they charge, and that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, behold, my servant, whom I have chosen, my beloved, in whom my soul is well pleased. I will put my spirit upon him. He shall show judgment to the Gentiles. He shall not strive nor cry, neither shall any man hear his voice in the streets. A bruised reed shall he not break, and smoking flax shall he not quench, till he send forth judgment unto victory, and his name shall be, and in his name shall the Gentiles trust. What's that? Who's that? Jesus. Mine elect. Over there in Isaiah 42 is a reference to Jesus Christ. In the Bible, one usage of the word elect, by the way, did you see? It says mine elect here. And when you transliterate from the Hebrew to the New Testament, it says my chosen one. Christ is God's chosen. He's God's elect. Amen. Praise the Lord. See, so wonder why. So you, when you read the word elect, you better be careful. There's other usages of the word elect in the Bible. Amen? They don't all refer to the church. And then the application to the church, which I have to get into next week because we're running a little bit over here. You got to understand some dynamics in salvation. If you don't get that straight, you got people saved before they believe. That's what John Calvin taught, by the way, in his institutes. I'm not saying everybody who ascribes to Calvinism believes that, but that's what John Calvin taught, that people are saved before they believe. That's a problem. The Bible says so, and we'll look at that, Lord willing, next week. So, refers to the Lord Jesus Christ. He's called my elect. One other one, 1 Peter 2:6, and we got to stop. We got to stop there, and we'll pick it up. Amen. I can see the numbers dropping already. It don't matter. I'm going to preach the truth. Amen. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Amen. Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Sion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Who's that referring to? Everybody? Christ, I'm not trying to get you to say what I want you to say. You just read the passage and say, who is he? Whose name do you got to? It's in the name of Christ. He's the chief cornerstone. That's who he is. God says he's God's elect. So when you look at the word elect, you better make sure you include that one in your list of usages. Amen? Just compare scripture with scripture. Anyway, so we got to go on, and we'll do that next week, Lord willing. Amen. But there's a couple of other usages. There's three others. Really? Yes. That's what happens when you study your Bible instead of going by some institutes. Because you read that stuff, man, you get, I'll tell you, my daughter Jessica here, she tried to do something there in the school there and try to write some stuff. I tried to help her, and anyway, it was a bit of a challenge. Yeah. Why? Because she gave scripture. She gave scripture. Because the person that marked it was Calvinist. That's what it boils down to. Serious. That's the way life goes sometimes. People will place more loyalty to a book rather than the Bible. Or what someone said rather than study it out yourself and read up on it. Amen? Amen. Amen. Again, I pray for people. I pray for people. I'm not fighting. By the way, I'm not fighting those people. But if someone comes in here, I'm the shepherd of this flock. And if you want to promote that stuff here, amen, you're going to have a meeting with me. We're going to meet. We're going to talk. I'm not going to harm you. That's not a threat that way. I just, listen, you got to watch that stuff. Gets in the church. It'll spread. You know, you say, well, I like John MacArthur. I like him. You might say that. Whatever. I'm not saying he preaches everything wrong. He doesn't. But he has Calvinist leanings. He does. I don't know what point he is. I have his study Bible at home. So I'm going by knowledge, not by what I heard from somebody else. I have his study Bible at home. A New American Standard. I have it for reference when people make statements. Well, I don't think John MacArthur believes this. Here it is, right here. That's what I do. Let's go by right from the horse's mouth. I don't hate him. I believe he's a godly man. He is. That's not a statement of hate. He's a godly man. He really is. I have no qualm with that. Just that Calvinism stuff. Amen. Yeah, I'm bringing the numbers down lower again. But anyway, so you got to be careful. You really got to be careful. Otherwise, you say, man, I want to study to learn the Bible, but what I preach and teach, if you study and scripture with scripture, and then you fill your head with all this other stuff, you're going to tear down all the things that I've just preached to you. What's the point? Why are you doing that? It's like, it's futile. You're going backwards again. Amen? So anyway, and again, I'm as a pastor, I'm for anybody who wants to sit down one-on-one. It's kind of awkward these days with all this COVID stuff, but I'll do that. I'll sit down with people. You know, every time I've asked people to do something like that, a lot of them just refuse. They don't want to sit down. I've had to tell some people, not on the Calvinist issue, but on the mess up on the wrath, the pre-tribulation rapture, they believe in the pre-wrath position. And I asked questions on the phone. They came and just wanted to check bases, touch bases with them, but started asking questions. Looked, found something on YouTube. They just love this guy, Stephen Anderson. Stephen Anderson believes in salvation by grace through faith, but he's messed up on the rapture. And what I did was I said, he says, oh, I agree with Stephen Anderson. Well, he's messed up on the elect. In Matthew 24, he puts the church in Matthew 24 there. The church is in the tribulation. He believes that. And you know what I did? I said, listen. He says, well, listen, I do agree. And he started arguing with me on the phone. I said, listen, you came one time and you're already arguing with the pastor. That doesn't sound like this is going to be a good relationship. I says, listen, maybe you need to find another church. Because we don't want, listen, I don't want discord here. It's not an issue of everybody's got to agree with me. Let's agree with the Bible. And if it's not according to the scriptures, what are you doing? Amen. Let's go by the Bible. That's where we need to go. The Bible is the standard. This is an absolute authority. It's not me. I'm not the authority. The Bible is. So that's why I watch out, man. We've had episodes over the year, different people. You know, coming in here trying to spread some false teaching. Take people aside. Talk to them downstairs privately. I'm serious. You got to watch that. I watch. I kind of keep an eye and an ear open. Amen. What's going on? Try to. As you get older, it gets tougher. But anyway, let's all stand. Lord willing, hope to see you in the new year. But anyway, let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you again for your goodness. Thank you, God, for answers to prayer. Thank you, Father, for Lord God, as we get closer to finishing this year, God, help us. Help us not wait till January 1st to deal with some things in our lives. Help us to act upon them now, Lord God. Lord God, help us not to boast ourselves of tomorrow, but Lord God, help us to realize tonight, Lord God, that you have not guaranteed us any more days than what we have right now. God, tonight could be the last time we would see each other again, all the same group here. God, help us tonight. Be with your people. Encourage and strengthen each and every one. Pray for those who are lost. Lord God, I pray, God, that you would work in the hearts and lives of people. Lord God, meet with each and every need. And Father, I pray tonight that you would again have your will and way be done. And Father, just give us all safety as we go our separate ways. And may we bring honor and glory to you in our lives. And we'll thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you all.